This programme is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome to another delightful episode of A Different Kind of Woman. A Different Kind of Woman is willing to listen and learn. For 500 years since the invention of movable type, we have valued the ability to read and write as the primary means of communicating and understanding history, cultural traditions, political and social philosophy, and the news of the day. A study by the International Centre for Research states women are more likely to control their own destinies and affect change in their own communities when they have higher levels of education. On today's show, To Read and Write, we are going to be discussing how to inspire empowerment through one of the best platforms, education. Let's take a look at what's coming up on the show. Next, we're going to find out what people on the streets of London think with Anna Maria.
A lot more about getting the grades and doing all of the box ticking in order to get the right grade, rather than introduce a love of learning and reading. And a lot of that is due to what courses are being available.
See the clothes that fund education in a Tina Labandi fashion show. And we'll be welcoming progression manager from the charity City Year UK, Zipporah Kissy, to our studio.
At the end of the year, the little boy in assembly was like, thanks for teaching me English.
Oh, I was just like, amazing.
Hold me. And this is assembly in front of loads of kids in school, and you want to thank me. Yeah. So it actually does work. So I've gone from being a volunteer to management in the last 7 years. So I've developed as well, and that's made me feel like I can make a difference too.
Obviously, I'm not discussing the topic alone, and joining me today is the game-changing Gemma.
Wow.
You've got lots of
what a tall order. Game changer. Okay, I'll take it.
Driven Diane.
Hi.
Well, after that lead up, thanks, Diane. And the sensational Sandra.
Oh, wow. Sensational.
I said game changing, not singing.
I know. Well, we're changing the game right now. Exactly.
Well, anyway, on today's show, To Read or Write, we're going to be discussing global literacy. Now, ladies, can you tell us about a favourite teacher or someone who made a difference in your education? Don't all shout at once.
Yeah. I had a teacher, I think, this was at A-level, actually, and she taught me biology, and I would say that she did change the way I saw the subject, just because it was quite difficult at the time to do A-level biology, but she made it so personal to herself. Like, she would, like, we were talking about reproduction and all that stuff, and, you know, sometimes it's not the most interesting of stuff at that time. And then she brought in, like, this chicken from the supermarket and was like, look, a baby's like this. It's the size of this. And imagine this coming out of you. And she just made it so much more interesting that I never forgot her. And it made, you know, she brought the curriculum to life. And I thought that was really, really interesting. And when you've got a teacher who actually is passionate about what they do and they care for you and they want you to do well and they're willing you on and they add in their own passion, I think it does make a difference.
Yeah, I do agree with Gemma, actually. I had a teacher in primary school. I loved her. She really made education really interesting. She took me as her own daughter. She helped me with the subjects that I was struggling with. And she was always there for me to listen to me, not only just, you know, with my education, but with anything. She was really like a second mum in my school. And I loved her. I'd never forget her until today.
Okay. Amazing.
I had a primary school teacher. I was really digging deep, you know, when you asked, that's why I didn't speak. But I had a primary school teacher who, he was fun at teaching. And I enjoyed that then, because I really don't... you'll see I'm on the other side of the fence to you guys, because I left school with no exams. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm the other side of the fence. But he was one that I actually did really remember, and I liked him.
So. Yeah. I had a good teacher for English and English literature. And I remember I came to hand in the coursework for GCSEs and I hadn't done it. And this was like three essays and stuff. And what he actually made me sit in his class the whole day, regardless of what year group he was teaching, and made me complete the coursework. And I finished with, like, I got a B for speaking and listening and then 2 C's for English and English literature. So that was all down to him. So he could have just been like, okay, she's not bothered, and I'm not going to be bothered either. Uh-huh. But yeah, he was brilliant. Mr. Fielding. No. Okay, but before we delve further into the topic, let's find out what people on the streets of London think with Anna Maria.
How do you think global literacy can be improved?
I feel that it's difficult with today, with how much people do tend to read on social media and online, when a lot of stuff is published by not established publishers. So there's a lot of, I see them all day, every day, a lot of grammatical errors, a lot of spelling mistakes, and this isn't good practice and this isn't good education. So I guess I think reading more, like the enhancement of libraries, they need to be pushed more. I'm not sure how, but it needs to be pushed more that people actually like read a proper book, read the actual newspaper, watch the news, that sort of thing.
Well, my experiences in school was that it's a lot more about getting the grades and doing all of the box ticking in order to get the right grade, rather than introduce a love of learning and reading. And a lot of that is due to what courses are being available, in my opinion at least.
I think the government should definitely be like investing more money into education and like actually maybe like hearing from parents, like with their opinions on like what they think schools should be doing more to like help as well, and maybe like have just more like charity events to like raise money for obviously countries that can't like have like good education like through their government and stuff.
Global literacy would surely be improved by further education, specifically in third world countries or countries that have a lower literacy rate than the Western countries we live in.
And what about, how much do you think your own education could have been improved?
I think my own education was actually, I was very lucky, my own education was very good, but across the country I think that education needs to be standardised, and that it's, the difference in a lot of institutions education-wise can cause some people to be disheartened with their education and not fulfil their true potential.
I'd be really up for some kind of debate, you know, something like Question Time, for instance, where they have people higher up actually listening to the students, because at the end of the day, we are mature students and we're old enough to make our own decisions. And I don't always feel that I get enough back for the money that I'm paying for my course. And when I complain about it, it's sort of, where does it go from there? It doesn't really get listened, because it takes a bigger voice for someone to get heard.
Like I said, if there was less box ticking and kind of an agenda of grades and statistics rather than a love of learning, because the whole school system is set up so that unless you're average or above, you're not doing well enough. But the problem is the way averages work means that the majority of people are not average or above.
Well, because I'm from Brazil, like the education there, it's obviously like free, but it's not like as of a good standard as free education in London. So I think, I don't know, so it's a bit more like you don't really learn the subjects, like it's very like academic and not very like people, because I'm a more of a creative student, like I didn't really get that opportunity to like explore like my creative, I don't know, I didn't like expand on my creative like processes when I was studying in Brazil, because they're more like, oh, you need to do math, you need to learn English, you need to like do all of those things. So I think here definitely it's a lot better, like doesn't even compare to like the education in Brazil.
Do you have any questions on this subject?
I would like to know more about how it is effective in different countries, because I know UK is known for having a good education system, it claims, in comparison to other countries. But I am also well aware that education isn't as good in some countries. So I guess I'd like to learn more about that and how we could help those countries.
so the question from the last one, I don't know exactly how much we could tell her, because we're not politicians, but in terms of how the creative differences in, I guess, in other countries, the educational, differences in other countries. I've only been educated in the UK. Gemma, you've had an education in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
And Sandra, have you?
No, it's only UK, but I do have family members who's had education elsewhere, and it works so different compared to here.
Yeah. Okay, so, Caribbean, for example.
Yeah, to be honest, I really loved my Caribbean education. So I did it from 12 to 15, and I came back and I literally went through my GCSEs, that with flying colours. It was just so easy, because the thing about the Caribbean is I lived in St. Lucia at the time. They take education, I feel like this is a generalisation, but I feel like in general they take it a lot more seriously, just because, you know, there is no welfare state to grow up and fall back on. Your parents are actually paying for your education. So I went to a private school, so my parents paid for that. But then even when you go to like the public schools, you still have to pay for every term you've got to pay a fee. And then on top of that, you don't get any exercise books for free like you do here. So the exercise books, you need to go to a set schooling shop to buy them. You buy your uniform, you buy your PE kit, you buy everything that you need. You buy your pencils, you buy everything. Nothing is provided.
So you don't take it for granted,
Don't, because your parents are paying for it. Mm. And it's like, you know, every term that money is going to. And then the other thing, which I think even more than my parents paying for it, was the fact that if you don't, and I think Sandra had a similar experience with some of her family members in Europe, if you don't pass your exams, you just simply won't go ahead. Yeah. Simple. You stay behind. And the embarrassment of having to stay behind and be in a class with people who are maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 5, 6, 7 years younger than you, because you don't progress, is enough to say, actually, I'm going to study for my exams. And that's how it is. And I came back to Europe just before my GCSEs, and they were so easy. I did a lot more subjects out there as well. I think when I left, I was doing about 15 subjects. So you do all the sciences, you do the maths, but you have to do stuff like cooking. It teaches you for life as well. I had to do sewing and embroidery, but this is not like, you know, make a simple little bag. You're literally doing embroidery. Like, it was incredible. And a lot more is demanded of you. Mm-hmm. And I came back and I not only had like all the sort of sciences and the maths and so on, but I also had social skills. I could cook, I could sew, you know, I could go out and make things. They teach you how to start your own business and stuff like that. So it was just a great all-rounded education. And sports was taken very much, very seriously as well. So I really recommend it. I thought it was great. Okay. Really good.
Well, we are running out of time, but we do have time for a quick red and green card.
Yay.
Game, really. So if you've got your red and green card.
I don't know where it is, actually.
Might be sitting on
sitting
it here.
On it, Emma.
Oh, keeping it warm.
Okay,
there
so
you
remember,
go.
Ladies, it's no on the fence. Green is yes. Well, no, no. Don't worry, Clem, we'll get them in the break.
Get the cards after.
Get them in
there
the
you
break.
Go.
Don't worry. Okay, so did you have a good education?
Yes.
Yeah, I would say.
See, you're saying not to be on the fence.
Yeah.
It's, I know. And
talking,
before I said I left school without having any exams.
Yeah.
I retract that because I did get two. and I need to be on the fence with this one because I only left with two.
Was that because
you were truanting?
No, was that because of your behaviour or the education that you was provided to you?
Right. So I could stand outside one of my maths classes and say, I'm not coming in today. And she'll be like, okay then. And she'll shut the door.
Oh, my goodness.
And she'll
goodness.
Carry on.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's why I'd like to be on the fence, because I didn't have, even if I wanted to, and I think it was because I didn't like maths, mm-hmm. and I didn't understand it very well, and so I just thought, I don't want to do this. But if you had a teacher, like you were saying, you know, that kind of pushed you, maybe I would have come out with a C or...
But still, you know, the behaviour of the teacher, that's still not necessarily that they still weren't providing.
Well, she wasn't... Obviously, it wasn't a good education. If you had a teacher that would just shut the door on you and say, OK, no problem. You know, that wasn't one... I wasn't one pupil. There were several.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's
a part of me does agree with that. Just because I was talking to a teacher last night and she was saying she dealt with some difficult students, and she said there is a lot of pressure on teachers anyway. You've got 32 children
children, but she said, you know what, some of them, the most problematic ones, I took them and I almost became like a mother to them. And she said she saw one of them, and still last night she was crying about it. She said, it brings tears to my eyes because I looked at him and I thought, I changed his life, mm-hmm. this guy. He was a nightmare and I changed his life. So I guess that's what you're talking about. Yeah. If you had someone that would just invest in you a little bit more. Yeah. And give you a little bit more time. I hear what you're saying. Yeah.
Ladies, we've run out of time, which is that. Oh,
yeah. Sandra can speak in the next segment.
No. Sorry, it's been passionate. I'm passionate right. about this.
We embrace the passion. It's okay. But because of that, we're now going to take a short break. There's just enough time to grab a snack and for Gemma to pick up her cards.
I know,
so we'll
indeed.
We'll be right back soon with some more exciting discussion. Welcome back, and on today's show, To Read and Write, we've been discussing women's empowerment through education. Now, joining us in the studio is Progression and Alumni Manager for City Year UK, Zipporah Kissy.
Hi.
Welcome, Zipporah. So, what are the aims of City Year UK? What's
City
it about?
City Year is a youth and social action charity. What we do, we get young people between 18 and 25 to work in schools as near peer support. Mm-hmm. So, they're mentors, tutors, role models. They volunteer full time for an academic year of service. So, Monday to Thursday, the earliest 7:30 for breakfast club. And late for after school club, in class support. And then as they give, they also gain for our development programme. So we kind of train them professional skills, how to write a CV, how to get into the world of work, communication skills, and that's for the whole year.
That is brilliant. Yeah. How long has that been running for?
So it started in America in 1988. So it's in every state in the States, and it came to UK in 2010 is when I started as well. Okay. And we're currently in Manchester, West Midlands and London.
Wow. Okay, so some of the major points. Yeah. That's brilliant.
So why are you so passionate about this charity?
It's pretty personal to me. I think it works. So I joined City in 2010 when it first started, and I dropped out of university because of depression. So I didn't finish university. I just kind of just got through the second year. Mm. And as you can imagine, all my friends were getting big boy jobs and doing well and making money. And I was little old me was like, oh, what am I going to do? Yeah. So although I was working 3 part-time jobs, so I'm a grinder, I don't sit still, I also feel like I was always making it short compared to my friends. Mm. So I found City, I was like, let me give back. I born and raised in Hackney. The school I was in was in Hackney. So I thought, let me give back to what we do. And during the service, I realised it actually works. I worked with 2 siblings from Bangladesh and Thailand, no English, limited social skills. At the end of the year, the little boy in assembly was like, thanks for teaching me English.
Oh, I was just like, amazing.
Hold me. And this assembly in front of loads of kids in school, and you want to thank me. Yeah. So it actually does work. So I've gone from being a volunteer to management in the last 7 years. So I've developed as well, and that's made me feel like I can make a difference too.
It's great.
It sounds amazing. It really does. What do you think prevents young people from reaching their potential?
I think it's a lack of self-belief and no one to believe in them. So for me personally, having depression in ethnic community is not widely known in its first instance. So I couldn't talk about it with anyone. I couldn't be free to get the help that I needed. Whereas nowadays, if people have gone through loads of things, they can be like, this is how I dealt with it. This is what you can do to get through it. So we have someone that can kind of be holding their hands, so to speak, to get through. It makes a big difference. So because there's no support, I feel, people feel lost in the system.
See, the support, it's really important. I didn't get that support. Mm. Don't get me wrong, you know, it didn't stop me. Mm. It hasn't stopped me, people. Mm. It hasn't stopped me, yeah? But, you know, it's crucial, the support, you know, I could have gone further, you know, with that support.
Mm. Mm. Do you ever get any feedback from the teachers about why they might be like how what you know Diane is saying? I know there's loads of pressure in teaching these days, you know, the class sizes and even people not speaking English. If you are teaching a class of like, you know, 35 people and you've got so many, you know, you could have maybe like 10 different languages in one class. So do they ever give you feedback about maybe how they feel, why they have, for want of a better word, lacked giving the support?
So like you said, teacher's role is not as one-to-one as we'd hope it to be. So they manage 30 children at one time. The thing they take home with them is immense. Like their holidays aren't really their holidays. Mm-hmm. So I think one thing City, I think is good. We go in and we're like children support. They have TAs for the teachers. We support the children. So someone that can be one-to-one, but like, I realised you didn't come to school yesterday, or your clothes are a bit dirty today, what's going on? And they could be the eyes and ears on the ground. Mm. And they're a bit distant and detached from the actual students, which is a shame. Yeah,
you know, it's difficult because just speaking to some teachers, I think they also have guilt. Mm. And that's the thing. I think they want to do better at times. And, you know, not that I'm sort of justifying like what you went through, Di, for instance, but, you know, if you have got 30 kids, sometimes it's like you can't always pick up, like, oh, my goodness, like you said, their shirt's dirty and what's happened and so on. Because, you know, let's face it, teachers do an awful lot and they're not paid very much. And there's so much marking to do, and then you're taking work home with you, and then you're coming back, and sometimes you've got another class to look after on top of that, and, you know, it's really, really hard. And I think sometimes you've got 30 people to look after, and you're just thinking, I need to get through this curriculum, because they've got those pressures as well. So sometimes it's not always as easy, and it's wonderful to have a charity like yours that can sort of make up for what they can't do.
But you, Sabora, you actually sound passionate about what you do as well, and I think
that's true.
Really does make a difference, you know.
True.
Sometimes you can start a job and you can really love that job, but because of all of the politics that's going on along with it, you end up just doing the job the way the job meant, you know, just getting in, going, you know.
Ticking the box, like they said.
Basically, right? But you sound passionate, and I think that's the key to teaching.
Definitely.
You have to be passionate, you know. You have to be able, it's not just about teaching. It's actually about having those 30 students and thinking, hold on a minute, I know this, something's wrong here. That's the part of your job, actually.
Trying to impact lives.
Do you understand?
Can I just ask you, just out of curiosity, how inclusive do you think education is?
I think it's getting better from when I was at school. I think there's still more to do. So before, it was quite overt about religion and race and culture. But I feel like the attainment gap is the problem. So what I mean by that, if you're doing really well at school, gifted and talented, you get the support, you get knowledge, you get achievements. If you're doing not so well, like special educational needs, additional support. If you're in the middle band, you kind of get forgotten. And you kind of just kind of coast through, and you never achieve your full potential, but you never kind of fail, so you're all right because you pass. So I feel like for inclusivity, we need to do more to make sure those people aren't forgotten and left by the wayside. So having people like mentorships or partial support going to schools to make a difference will help close that gap a bit more, I think.
That's a good point, actually, because, yeah, usually if you're doing really well, of course you'll notice. It's like, you know, you become a prefect or whatever. You know, all the, I can't actually remember. It's just, you know, so long ago now.
Here she goes.
You like that one better, didn't you? But back on the point. But and if you're doing really badly, like, you know, you're maybe you're a troublemaker or what have you, then people know. But you're right, there are so many in the middle. And it's quite difficult as well because, again, if you are a teacher spending a lot of time on people who are disruptive and then you're thinking, okay, this person is doing so well and I want to invest in them, how can you do that for, like, 30 people, for instance? It's quite difficult. It's really, really hard.
Yeah, so our young people have focused list students who are in that middle band. So they work with them day in, day out to make sure they are recognised and they do achieve and they do progress. So I think just when I trump it, we do kind of add to that and make sure they're not forgotten.
That's really helpful.
Do you get any good feedback from parents who might have noticed then the difference between, like, before you guys stepped in and then as you're working?
Yeah, all the time. Because we're there in the morning, so when they come in for the gates, we're there saying hi in our red jackets. So they notice us, they know the difference. They, like, know us by name and by face. And we've been in school for 7 years straight through, so we have a good relationship with them throughout. And we've also mentioned Ofsted as well. So both sides, the parents and with government, were noticed.
So how does this work? So if a parent's watching at home and thinks, wow, my child could benefit from this, is it the school that has to take you on board as a whole, or is it something that parents can approach you, you know, just one-to-one? How does the whole thing work?
It's more for the school side. So the school will invest in what we do and get a team to back me up the school. And then once the school takes part of it, for the head teacher, senior leadership team, then they will be in the school and then we run through. So it's more the school side that will endorse it.
Okay.
So are you in their lessons? Do you help them, like, with their schoolwork, homework, I should say, and things like that as well?
So we're in breakfast club. So before they start school, where they're making sure they get a good breakfast in their class. So whether it's maths, numeracy, literacy, whatever they do, in the playground, at lunchtime, literally every part of their day, they'll see a red jacket. After school club, they do activities themselves and they do homework clubs. So they're literally there from the first they see at the school to the last that they leave.
That's amazing. You know why this is good? Because when you think about the playground, sometimes it can be a really scary place as well. And that's where a lot of bullying can take place. And if you know that you've got somebody who's on your side,
is almost like a big brother or big sister. Definitely. And I think, because if you think about education and what can impact your education, when I think about my school time, there was a point in primary school where I was bullied, and that impacted my education because I didn't want to go to school, and then I would pretend that I was not well, and then obviously you miss certain classes and you can't catch up. Or if you're just not feeling good, like you said, you had an issue with depression, which made you drop out of uni. If you don't feel good about yourself, you can't push yourself to your full potential. And that is a lot of the things that do affect. So it would be good if people can recognise those things that are almost external to education that impacts education as well.
How do you think we can inspire children to engage with education? You know, because it is a massive problem. There's so many distractions. There's social media. There's people wanting to be in gangs. There's people, you know, wanting to make money quickly. And there's so many children as well who they may be from single parent families or families who are working so much that they're not able to invest in family time. So obviously these things get, you know, lost by the wayside. So how can we, what would you be your key tips that we can inspire children to engage with education and see the importance of it?
I think a lot of it is about access. What you're saying, we see a lot of the negative side of social media. We don't see positivity much. So I think as young as primary school, so at 7, we just show them what you can achieve, who you can be. This person who you admire or this person who's just something else did X, Y, Z to get there. Learning from leaders in the fields, whether they're celebrities or not, we can access the positive role models continuously. And I think we see a lot of negativity, overwhelmingly too much. But if we kind of counteract that with positive things, whether it's role models or mentors or tutors or aspirations, they will see something else and be able to trigger that more so than the things they see that are bad.
Yeah. Oh, I love that. It's true. There does need to be the showing the more of the positive role models, because everyone is so quick to be, you know, videos of people fighting or, you know, people that are half naked. And, you know, instead of showing the things, the powerful things that people have done. I mean, I think I saw in the media, it didn't hit like wide stream. It was like last week sometime, a 22-year-old girl who is in NASA. So she's an already, like, working as an, forgive me if I got the wrong, but aeronautical engineer. So she's not even finished, like, I think it's MIT that they go to out there. And so she's the youngest person in her field to do that. But yet that doesn't hit wide stream. We see, you know, pregnancy pictures on Instagram, you know, rather than, and of course, you know, I'm not putting her down, but it's like the positive things for people. Yeah. So I think it's amazing what you guys are doing. Please, long may it continue, and schools, take them up. Okay. Yeah. No, thank you so much for sharing everything with us today. It's great. So we're going to take a short break, but don't go away, as we'll be back with more on To Read or Write. Welcome back, and on today's show, To Read or Write, we have been discussing the benefits of education. Now, as funny as it may sound to us, even in this country, it wasn't until 1975 that it became illegal to discriminate against educating women, and in many parts of the world, women are not given the right to read. That's scary. So in what ways do you think not being given an education would prevent you from reaching your full potential?
I think that a lack of education can lead to people having a low sense of value. And I think that, you know, some people don't have enough confidence if they're not educated. And I can even give my example. Although I was taught to read and write, if I'm ever put in a situation, it could be a job or anything, where I feel that, wow, they're talking about stuff that I have no idea what they're actually talking about. And I've been in meetings like that before. I've started jobs and I was just like, this has just gone over my head. And, you know, I don't feel confident as I would in speaking about something that I know and I'm confident about. In those situations, you're kind of like, gosh, if they choose me to talk right now, I'm just going to have to wing it or be like, no, pass, someone else. And that's the thing. You don't have the confidence to interact with people when you're not educated about a subject, whatever the subject might be. And I just think that if you don't have the access to education or you can't even read or write, you do feel like you're going to be ostracised from society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do agree with what she said with the lack of education, because I had lack of education. So, as I said, it didn't stop. I'm a go-getter, so it didn't stop me. But I've been in situations where we've had a conversation like, don't know what they're talking about.
That's it.
You know, and you know, I'm a very confident person at the best of times. You guys know me, but it does kind of knock your confidence as well.
Yeah.
And, you know, would I turn it around at a shot?
Yeah.
Would I want that education at a shot?
Yeah.
You know?
It's all,
I think it doesn't stop you completely, but it does affect you a lot. It affects your self-esteem. It affects how you see yourself. It really does. I really do think so.
Yeah, you're right, because it's a passport, really. When you think about it, if you don't do certain exams, like you said, then it's almost like you don't have that passport to get you to the next level.
That's right.
Then if you don't do those, you don't have the passport to get you to maybe like university. Yeah. And sometimes, especially in the Western world, I know here in the UK, you're judged on so many different things. Yeah. Where did you go to school? Where were you? What did you study at university? Yeah. What university did you go to? And to be honest with you, realistically, I have seen in my walks of life that how you were educated or not, where you were educated or not, can stop you from getting certain opportunities.
Yeah, you're right.
And if you're not that sort of person that's going to be like, no matter what, I'm going to go above and beyond and, you know, break the norms and break everything that society puts on me, you are not going to do better.
Yeah.
It's as simple as that.
Yeah.
If you don't have that determination within yourself, because I would sit here and be lying if I said that, you know, no, it's all rosy. It doesn't matter where you are educated. It doesn't matter if you don't get an education or not. It doesn't matter where you were schooled or not. Life's going to be easy. Life isn't like that, especially here in the UK. And I feel that if you don't have that extra determination when you're a grown up, that you're not going to succeed if you don't have that. And it's just so much easier if we could just teach our young people the value of education. Like, this is going to affect your future. It's going to affect the jobs you get. It's going to affect your financial income, the people that you meet, what you have access to. It's going to affect your whole life.
Yeah, you really actually need education.
You do need it.
To just get on with the day-to-day things of life.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys, we'll continue this afterwards. But we have to watch a video now. And this is, we went to see a designer who is funding education for girls and boys in the Congo. So find out more about Tina Labondi in this video.
I'm here with Tina Lumbondi at her Isimbi Fashion fundraiser. So we're here to find out how fashion empowers women. Hello, Tina.
Nice to see you.
So tell us, in your opinion, how do you think, how do you hope fashion can empower women?
Well, I'm hoping that fashion will empower women in a sense that they can express their identity a little bit more, in not just the way they dress, but also the style that they will choose in the future. But also, I did a talk actually yesterday, and after the talk, there's a lady that came to me and said that seeing what we do with Isimbi gave her the thrill to start her own social organization. So it's I think this is what fashion can do as well, is just empower and motivate others in doing more for themselves and the community.
Okay. So how do you believe perceptions of the Congolese culture can change?
I believe that if Congolese people show their culture more, then people will make less, they will see what the culture is about, so they wouldn't have to guess or make assumptions about it. They will just, you know, we will show them what Congolese culture is about. And I think this is up to, you know, Congolese people to do. It's not, you know, because people will always see what you show them. So if we're showing them the bad side of Congo, then this is how they perceive Congo. So for me, this is Congo. Isimbi is Congo, is the education, is the children, is the future, and, you know, is this beautiful hotel, it's the models, it's my collection. So this is Congo to me.
And tell us, how do you think education can empower?
To me, education is power. So that's something I always say. To be educated, it means that gives you room to, you know, to do more, room to learn, to also help people, and to help yourself. So if you're educated, you'll be able to do that because you'll have the knowledge to do so.
So tell us, Tina, what can we see and expect on the catwalk this evening?
Tonight you'll see my Autumn Winter Collection 17, and it is inspired by the Congolese flag colors. So hopefully people will have a good time and also enjoy the print, because it's going to be my first print for Tina Lebondi, designed by a graphic designer that we work with. So I hope people will like it. We are catering for boys and girls in Congo, so I'm hoping that fashion will have a good impact. And it's not just fashion, also it's just the industry of the arts that we're trying to promote in our activities. So, yeah, how it would impact? I mean, for us, it's more about education. So everything we're trying to do is to be focused on how we are bringing in new skills and also mentors that are going to contribute to the lives of these children.
Thank you so much, Tina, and I really look forward to the catwalk and to see your brand in action.
Amazing. Thank you so much for coming tonight. And I also hope that everyone will enjoy the fashion and the charity.
Okay, so educated women are likely to postpone marriage to an age when they are well prepared mentally and materially as well. And there are numerous studies that show how each additional year of schooling brings down fertility rates by a significant percentage. In our country alone, infant mortality rates among primary level schooled mothers are half of what they are when compared to illiterate mothers. Studies also show how women get more productive at work and thus command a better pay scale. International studies show that every additional year of schooling increases a woman's earning capacity by 15%. For a man, this figure stands at only 11%. How do you think education empowers girls?
I think it gives you, in a lot of situations, the right to make choices. And that's what we want in life, isn't it? You just want the right to be able to choose the lifestyle that you want, to choose the career that you want. I think the worst thing in life is when people try to make decisions for you. And a lot of that, it's a shame, really, because the more I talk about education, the more I see how the decisions we make when we're younger, and we're so young, and I guess this goes back to Diane's point about having that person, if it's a parent, a teacher, or both, ideally, to just push you, because, you know, you're so young when you're making some of these choices about your future that you need guidance. And people don't realise, I didn't realise when I was at school, that the decisions I was making in primary school, in secondary school, even at uni, they were going to really impact my life forever. Really.
Yeah,
you can
turn.
You're right. Can turn things around, and it's an exception, of course. But to be honest, you're setting the roots for your life, and you don't realise that when you're younger. And it'll just be nice if people would tell you that a lot more.
Yeah.
Like, look, this is your future we're thinking about here. This is going to impact you. You know where you live, where you work. So just think about it a lot more carefully, rather than, you know, I don't want to do maths. All right then, see you later. Yeah, close the door.
Yeah,
kind of. And that's how I feel. Do you think that people or children are not always ready to hear that or realise the impact that it is going to have on them at, say, primary school level? You know, yes, that's why I think they introduce, obviously, then to go to work or work experience, that's the word, when you're in, like, years 10 and 11,
yeah.
Because then they're thinking, OK, at this point, people will start to change. But do you not think that maybe it's the problem is that from when we are young, especially at primary school, is that we are taught to complete tests.
Mm-hmm.
We're not necessarily taught to go ahead and I guess to a career or an ambition, or that this is what this can lead to. It's that, you know, SATs from like what, 7 or 9, mm-hmm. is it? And then you're tested again and again. So it's almost the curriculum is aimed to make you pass the test, and your teaching is aimed to make you pass the test, not to make decisions for life.
Yeah.
I agree with what she's saying, because, you know, if you tell a primary school child, you know, this is going to affect your whole life, they're looking at you like,
all right, can I go and play now?
I'm 8 or I'm 9, like, you're ancient,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
When you were younger, didn't you think that
they were just too old and boring.
So, you know, and you didn't think that your time was going to go by so quickly that you'd actually be standing in the same shoes they are, saying that same very thing to another child.
But then I think, I wonder, is it the same with, like, private school? I don't think, I don't know, but
I just think it's a bit different. In private school, they sort of kind of, well, I haven't been to private school, but I think they already start implementing that, how education is important and it's going to affect your future.
So then smaller class sizes because you're paying for more, so you've got access to more. Yeah. So comparing that to state school of, as we were saying before, 35 children, 10 different languages, a teacher, some may be disruptive, and going back to what Zipporah was saying about the high achievers, the low achievers, and then the middle people that can get less left out. So I think it kind of points to that we need an education overhaul, as it were, to so we can think about being more, I don't know if like creative or more ambitious or working towards that, like this could be affecting more of a career path kind of thing. Mm. Introducing things like, kids know more about technology than we do. Definitely. So doing like coding and things like that, you know, obviously on a more, an easier level, but things like that can actually set career paths.
But, you know, just going back to, like, the SATs and testing and all that stuff, I know there's a lot of talk about, like, getting rid of SATs at a too young age, but to be honest with you, I quite liked the discipline that comes from that, because although you might not be able to teach a primary school child and say to them, oh, look, this is going to impact your career and who you marry, they're probably thinking, I'm not going to get married. But when you instill that discipline in children from a young age, look, life is about tests. Life is about interviews, it's about exams. Whatever you want in life, you're going to need discipline if you want to get onto the next level. And I think instilling that in children is not a problem. I think it's actually really good, because that's what life is like. You don't go through life and it's like airy fairy and, you know, I get what I want and hopefully people like me and, you know, hopefully I'll wake up and I'll be successful. It's not like that. You have to prepare for interviews at work if you want to continue to better yourself. Remember, education doesn't stop when you're in secondary school or uni. At work, if you want to keep up to date and you want to keep your confidence, you still need to update yourself in your role. Mm-hmm. So education, tests, exams, I think it's really good because it brings you the discipline that you need for life.
Do
you
have we have run out of time. You guys need to actually look at the clock as well, you know, to see what's going on. So I think you've heard quite a wealth of experience and opinions today. And I think the key thing is that education is important. And while that we, especially in the first world, have access to so many levels of education and all types of education, we should embrace it and we should make use of it every single day. So tell us your thoughts on the subject on Twitter, Facebook, or by emailing comments at dkw.me, and join us next week for another exciting episode of DKW. So stay tuned for A Different Kind of You.
This program is brought to you by UCKG.